Good morning. So let us start our second class on module 5. That is, in the previous module, we were discussing about the need for data converters, why we need data converters in our day-to-day life, and how we would have almost all physical signals in nature to be analog or continuous signals, how we can process them in the digital domain effectively. So we have very effective, very good digital computers today, very good processing devices, digital signal processors. So we will try to convert the analog signal which we measure physically into digital. We'll process it in the digital domain, and again we will convert it back to analog so that the user will get to know what has happened to the signal. Maybe transmitting the signal, maybe doing some other process with the signal, anything. And at the beginning, when we measure a physical signal or when we input a physical signal, it will be analog in nature. And we will use a digital to analog converter or a DAC in the beginning. And once we convert it, analog to digital converter in the beginning, where we convert the physical signal to a digital signal, and we'll process it in the digital computer, and then after doing the processing, we will convert it back to analog by using a digital to analog converter, ADC in the beginning and DAC in the ending. So we started our study of DACs in yesterday's class, and we said a digital to analog converter is the circuit which converts any digital signal to an analog or continuous signal. The digital signal is usually in the form of a digital input, which is normally binary, and the analog output would be a continuous signal like a sine wave or something. Okay, and we spoke about what do we mean by resolution of a DAC. The minimum step size or the smallest step size is known as resolution. It is given as Vref by 2 power n. We also said what is linearity of a DAC. So the output of a DAC will normally be in the form of a staircase waveform, because we are giving digital inputs, discrete inputs, and the output is analog in nature. So either we can join it as a staircase or we can join it as a straight line. The slope of that straight line represents the linearity of the DAC. Usually the linearity of the DAC should be same as its resolution, but if there is a difference, there is a reason for that, and that constitutes some error. So we measure those things. We discuss the first type of DAC, that is the R2R ladder DAC. In an R2R ladder DAC, as we can see, we are connecting resistors which are weighted by a factor of 2 to the power of n. So the first resistor is R, the next one is R by 2 power 1, the third one is R by 2 power 2, so on. So we connect resistors to the inverting input terminal, and the configuration is exactly similar to that of an inverting summing circuit. You see the left hand side is an inverting summing circuit. Here, instead of having three different voltages, we'll be connecting the resistors to either Vref, which is plus 5 volts, representing logic 1, or we'll be connecting it to ground, representing logic 0. Okay, and you will see the value of resistors will be weighted by a factor of 2 power n. So first resistor is R by 2 power 0, the next resistor is R by 2 power 1, the third one is R by 2 square, the fourth one will be R by 2 cubed or R by 8, so on. And as usual, I will have the feedback resistor Rf. And I told you it is optional if we want to overcome bias current and offset errors. If we want to overcome errors due to bias and offset values in the op-amp, we can include a resistor in the non-inverting terminal to ground, whose value will be same as the Thevenin's equivalent resistance from inverting terminal to ground. So this is optional. Wherever you want high accuracy, you want to avoid small errors also, then we do this normally. And we discussed how to make the connections and how the output looks. Since we are connecting all the inputs to the inverting terminal of the op-amp, you'll see the staircase going in the negative direction. That is, output voltage would be a negative value. As the digital input increases, the output voltage will also increase in steps. And we have connected it in steps only. And we saw what is meant by full scale voltage. And I showed you that the full scale output voltage will always be one step less than the reference voltage. If I give a V reference of 5 volts, the maximum analog output which we are going to see, or the full scale output voltage which you are going to see, will be, say, the maximum count for a 3-bit DAC binary count will be 111, corresponding to a numerical value of 7. So if the step size, if one step size accounts to 5/8 volts, which I have shown you in this case, then the full scale voltage will be 7 times 5/8, which will be around 35/8, which is exactly one step less than the VREF value. You can see the full scale voltage is at this point 35/8. Okay, so this is your full scale voltage. And the other things we have discussed, we showed the how to derive the expressions, and we also got the equation for the output of the binary weighted resistor DAC. And we wrote the table containing a 4-bit digital input and the corresponding analog output. And for the same 4-bit weighted resistor DAC, what would be the expression for output voltage we have shown. So all this we completed in the last class. Today's class, we will first discuss what are the disadvantages of weighted resistor DAC. We try to analyze and design the second type of DAC circuit, that is the R2R ladder DAC. And we'll also try to understand the working of an analog to digital converter. Okay, so if possible, we'll try to analyze one type of analog to digital converter, that is the successive approximation ADC, if time permits. So what are the disadvantages do you think the weighted resistor DAC will have? First thing, it requires a wide range of resistors. Say for example, if I have a 3-bit DAC, it doesn't matter. I need R, R/2, R/4. Whereas if I need an 8-bit or 10-bit DAC, imagine the resistor ratios. You need R, R/2, R/4, R/8, R/16, R/32, so on. I need R/2 to the power of 10 or 2 to the power of 9 if I need 10-bit DAC. If I need a 12-bit DAC, I need R/2 to the power of 11 as the smallest resistance, and the largest resistance will be R. So imagine, how can you obtain so many resistors following that ratio? And the wide range, the range of resistors will, it will range from R to R divided by 2 to the power of N. So the range is from very large to very small. And if this N value is larger, so larger the N, the smaller R/2 to the power of N will be. So remember, we need a huge range of resistors, which is quite difficult to obtain. And it requires several different precise input resistor values, especially one unique value per binary input bit. So all the resistors which we connect should be very precise and unique following the ratio. If one resistor is 10K, the next one should be 5K exactly. If it is 4.7K or if it is 5.1K, again the output voltage will change. It won't follow the equation perfectly. Okay, so you are expecting a step size of 0.5. You may get a step size of 0.6 or 0.4, something like that. So since there are small variations in the value of resistors, the step voltages will also vary, and the linearity of the DAC, that straight line joining all the analog points, even that linearity will reduce. Okay. So all these are problems when I don't have precision resistors of the prescribed value. all in weights of 2 power n. So practically it's difficult to get these resistors, especially when the number of bits are more. Understand that. So if the precise value is not available, as I told you, the result will be erroneous. I told you, instead of 0.5 step voltage, it may be 0.4 or 0.7, something like that. Therefore, we'll go for designing a new type of digital to analog converter known as the R2R ladder. It is mainly called so because, as you will see, it will consist of only two resistors, R and 2R, and it will form a ladder-like structure. We know a physical ladder which we use to climb to heights, right? Wherever you want to reach heights, you use a ladder and climb. This will resemble the structure of a ladder, and it will use just two components, R, a resistor of value R and another of 2R. I don't need a wide range like this, from R by 2 to the power of n to R. That's a huge range of resistors. I don't need such a huge range here. That's why it is called an R2R ladder type of DAC. So the questions which can be asked in the exam, what is R2R network type DAC or ladder type DAC? Explain with relevant expressions, and you can get a problem based on that DAC. This is just a typical problem. You can have any problem asked. So let's move on to what is a DAC involving two resistors R and 2R. So first, most important thing with this R2R is the requirement for the wide big range of resistors in the weighted resistor DAC is eliminated. I don't need a huge range of resistors like in the weighted resistor DAC. And only two values of resistors, R and 2R, are needed. And as usual, just like how we used in weighted resistor, we will connect the binary inputs through switches, B0 to B2 or B0 to B3, depending on whether we have a 3-bit DAC or 4-bit, so on. Okay. And we'll be connecting those switches in one position will be connected to ground. The other position of the switches will be connected to the reference voltage VREF. Remember that. So this is how it looks. We have a simple example of a 3-bit R2R ladder DAC. As you can see here, see, I have a set of resistors of value R and 2R downwards. So it forms a ladder-like structure. It looks like a ladder, as you can see here. 2R, R, 2R, R, 2R, R, something like this. Even RF will be equated to 2R. And one additional 2R we need here connected to the ground. The non-inverting terminal could be grounded, or if you want to avoid errors due to bias and offset, you can connect a resistance equivalent to the Thevenin's equivalent resistance at the inverting terminal to ground. Anyway, for now we will assume let it be grounded. Okay. And you can see these points are switches. All these are switches, B0, B1, B2. This is your MSB, the most significant bit, and B0 is your LSB, the least significant bit. And you see these switches can either be connected to ground or they could be connected to what? This VREF. Here we have used a negative VREF. The simple reason for doing that is I'll get a positive output voltage, because this complete ladder network is connected to the inverting terminal of the op amp. So if I give a positive reference, the final output voltage would be a negative value, as simple as that. So it doesn't matter whether you give VR as positive or negative, anything you can use. If you want a positive output voltage, give VR as a negative value. If you don't mind a negative output voltage, negative in the sense inverted in phase by 180 degrees. Instead of being like this, it will be inverted downwards. You'll have the ladder downwards. So if you don't mind a negative output, you can give positive reference. So this is your reference voltage, as you can see. And the feedback resistor is RF. So this is the connection diagram of a simple 3-bit R2R ladder type of DAC. Now, let us try to analyze this and see what would happen to the output voltage. So let's consider as an example, in the first case, I'll consider the digital input, that is the switch positions B2, B1, B0 to take the value 100. See, the switch positions B2, B1, B0 should take the values 100. So what will happen to the equivalent circuit of this now? The equivalent circuit will have this point B2 should get connected to minus VR. As you can see, this point B2 is connected to minus VR and B1 and B0 should be connected to ground. See, B1, B0 are both connected to ground and the equivalent circuit will look something like what I have drawn below. Is that clear? So I have to now simplify this circuit using the network analysis principles what we know, and we'll try to find the value of output voltage in this circuit. Is this clear? Any doubts so far? Why this is in this format? So we are trying to simplify this circuit and we are considering the digital input to be 100, which is almost half of the maximum, right? So the most significant bit is 1 and the other two bits are zeros. So you see B0 and B1 will be connected to the ground and B2 will be connected to VR, minus VR. So the equivalent circuit will again reduce to this form. Can you tell me how you'll get this simple circuit which we have here? See, the analysis is very simple. I told you to apply the network analysis principles. So just look at this circuit. What do I have? Let's start off from the leftmost end. What do I have in the leftmost end? I have 2R in parallel with 2R from this point to ground. See, from this point to ground, there are two resistors of equal value, 2R, and they are in parallel. So what's the parallel combination of 2R with 2R? The parallel combination becomes R. Yes or no? Half the value. If I have 10K in parallel with 10K, then the equivalent resistance would be 5K, half of 10K. Just like that, if I have 2R in parallel with 2R, you find out if you are doubtful, it is 2R into 2R divided by 2R plus 2R. That is the equivalent value of two resistors in parallel. So this will reduce to 4R square divided by 4R. So what will I have? I'll have the equivalent resistance as R, right? So this will reduce to R. Now this R will be in series with this R. Can you see here what I'm circling in the lower diagram? The R, which is the result of parallel combination of these two, is in series with this R. So in effect, from this point to ground, I have 2R. So if I try to write an equivalent circuit from this point, let me call it as point B to ground, I have 2R. And again, I have a 2R connected. This resistor 2R from point B to ground. This 2R is because of this whole network on the left side of B. And here you have a R and here you have a 2R, again minus VR. And this end I have a R. I can connect this point to ground because I can use the principle of virtual ground. The non-inverting terminal is at actual ground. So the inverting terminal would be at the same potential because of the concept of a virtual short between the two input terminals, as we have discussed in yesterday's class also. That is the result of high gain of the op amp. It appears like the two input terminals will appear shorted or they'll get the same voltages. Though it is not a physical short circuit and no current flows between the input terminals, the voltages at the two input terminals will turn out to be the same. So if one input terminal is connected to ground, the other will also be at ground potential. That's why this terminal is known as the virtual ground. So what I can do, I can connect this R to ground. So now you again simplify from the left hand side. You again have 2R in parallel with 2R, which will be R. R in series with this R, again R plus R, 2R. So effectively what I'm going to have, I'll have 2R here connected to ground. I have 2R here connected to minus VR and R here connected to ground. So this is the effective combination which I have finally when I come close to this point. See, this point is the inverting input. So this same circuit, I hope you understood how we are getting this. Any doubts, please interrupt and ask at any point of time. Do you have any doubts? So if I try to write the equivalent of that, I'm just rewriting this circuit. What I have here, you see, whatever I have here, I'm just trying to rewrite. I'll consider this 2R here, where I'm giving the supply of minus VR, and I have a 2R connected to ground and another R connected to ground. So what am I having here? It's a parallel combination of R with 2R in series with 2R, which is connected to minus VR. That's what we have written here. So the simplified equivalent circuit for this combination of digital input comes to this form. Now, what is the parallel combination of these two resistors? It will be 2R into R divided by 3R. So that will be 2 by 3 times R. The parallel combination of 2R and R, it is nothing but you have 2R into R divided by 2R plus R, which will be 2 by 3 times R. Okay. So what would be the voltage from this terminal? I'm calling this point as C. What would be the voltage from point C to ground? It is, using the principle of voltage divider, it is minus VR into the total resistance of this branch, which is 2 by 3 R, divided by the sum of this resistance 2R and 2 by 3 R. So the equivalent circuit now looks something like this. See, this is your point C. The resistance here is 2 by 3 R. The resistance here is 2 R. And here you have a supply minus VR. Okay. So the voltage, supply voltage V minus VR will be divided among these two resistors. And I'm trying to find this voltage VC. You use the principle of voltage divider. Minus VR into 2 by 3R divided by 2R plus 2 by 3R. If I simplify this, this value turns out to be minus VR by 4. You'll see the value VC will be minus VR by 4. So now if you look at the op amp structure, we have this voltage VC connected here. And what do I have here? I have the resistance RF, which is equal to 2R. And this is where we measure the output voltage. And so VC, between VC and 2R, I have a resistance R. So if you observe here, this is point C. Yes or no? This is point A, I can say, point B, point C. So this is your point C. From between point C and the inverting input terminal, I have a single resistance R, and then I have the feedback resistance 2R. I hope you are able to get that. And we have found what is the voltage VC. So this voltage VC here is how much? Minus VR by 4. Okay. So the voltage VC, which is connected here at the input, is minus VR by 4. And this is nothing but an inverting amplifier. Yes or no? Now the equivalent circuit reduces to that of an inverting amplifier. So the equivalent circuit, final equivalent circuit, is nothing but an inverting amplifier. What would be the output of the inverting amplifier? Minus RF by R1 into VI, right? So what is RF value here? RF value is 2R. So I have minus 2R. What is the R1 value? R1 value is R into what is the value of the input voltage? The input voltage is minus VR by 4. We have got that VC. VC is supposed to be the input voltage at this point, whose value was found as minus VR by 4. So when I simplify this, you can see this value turns out to be the output will reduce to VR by 2. Minus into minus becomes plus. R and R cancels out. 2 cancels out with this 4. So you're going to get the final output as VR by 2, which is nothing but the full scale output voltage VFS divided by 2. See, the full scale output voltage we'll say can be approximately equal to the reference voltage VR. Though it is one step size less than that, we'll say it's approximately the full scale output will be almost equal to VR. So if I say the final output voltage will be VR by 2, I can write it as the full scale output voltage VFS by 2. This is a small approximation, one step size less. That will do. Did you understand this? If you have any doubts in this derivation, please ask. Because this is how you will do it for a 4-bit also. So I have shown you the derivation for finding the output voltage in a 3-bit R2R ladder DAC for one input condition. So even when asked in the exam, you will do it for one input condition and then you will generalize for the remaining. If they ask you to derive it only for one condition and show how the output voltage will be VR by 2 or VFS by 2. And next we can generalize. So similarly, the switch position can change to 001, it can be 010, anything. So actually next we can do for 010 and then 001 if we want to prove completely. But for now, we'll just show how it looks for 001. So the switch positions, how will the circuit look? So remember this position was, this position was switch B0. This was B1. This was B2. And the values chosen for B0, B1, remember B2 is the most significant bit. The values chosen are 001. Okay. So you have 001 as the values chosen, which means B2 should be connected to ground. B1 is connected to ground, whereas B0 is connected to the reference voltage minus VR. Okay. So you will observe this as the equivalent circuit. And if I try to simplify this equivalent circuit, I have to go on doing it by finding the voltages at each of these nodes. So I will solve using network principles and I'll try to find the voltages at node A, the voltage at node B, then the voltage at node C. I'll analyze this circuit and finally I will consider the voltage at node C. I will find VC and then I will find the final output voltage. The same principle is followed. So when I do that, you see, I have considered VR to be in the leftmost position and this 2R is what is shown here. The 2R grounded from node A. See, this is node A, this is node B and this is node C in your circuit. So from node A, the 1 2R which is grounded is this resistor. This resistor is what is shown here. and this resistor is shown on this side. Okay, then you'll observe that the voltage at this point becomes approximately minus 21 by 64 into VR. So the voltage at node A, when I simplify, turns out to be minus 21 by 64 into VR. Similarly, voltage at node B will become minus 5 by 32 times VR. Voltage at node C becomes minus 1 by 16 times VR. And remember, I will use the voltage at node C to calculate the final output voltage. The final output voltage will be what? Minus 2R by R into, so it is inverting amplifier whose gain is RF by R1. RF is 2R and R1 is R, and I should have the inverted output. So minus 2R by R into what is the value of voltage at node C? It is minus VR by 16. So if I simplify this, what would I get? I will get VR by 8, or approximately I can say it is full scale output voltage by 8. So what do you observe? When the input value is 001, you get the output. So for, I'll show you in the next. So VFS by 8. Therefore, it can be generalized when input was 100. Okay, when the digital input was 100, we got the output voltage as what? VFS by 2. When the digital input was 001, we got the output as VFS by 8. So, can you generalize what would be the output voltage for this condition? You know how to write the circuit for this condition. So, what would be the output voltage for this condition? It would be surely VFS by 4. So, this would be the generalized condition for output for each of these. And for in-between values, when I have more than one bit high, I will add accordingly. So if the input is 110, the value will be VFS by 2 plus VFS by 4. Because both these are high. You add these two, you get 110. It will be the sum of these two voltages, whatever you are going to get it. Similarly, if you have 111, the voltage would be VFS by 2 plus VFS by 4 plus VFS by 8, like this. So the generalized expression for output voltage will be in the ratio. So I can have, I don't know whether I have written the generalized expression. I'll write it here only. For a 3-bit DAC, the general expression for output V naught can be, it can be what? Minus 2R by R, which represents the gain of the inverting amplifier, into, I can have what? VFS by 2 plus VFS by, this is 2 power 1 VFS by 2 square plus VFS by 2 cubed. So on, I can say VFS by what? Here, instead of VFS, you can simply write the bits also. Instead of writing VFS, I'll do one thing. I'll write it as the bits, because that will look more authentic. We are representing it in bits. B naught here. When B3 is high, I get this. What should I call it as? Let me say, what would you call B0, B1, B2, B3? In order, you can go on writing. If it is a 4-bit DAC, this will be B3. For a 3-bit DAC, this will be B2, B1, and B0 by 2 cubed. This is a 3-bit DAC. If you, this whole thing into the full scale output voltage or VR, you can write. If you want, you can modify it to an n bit DAC. For n bit DAC, what happens? The output voltage will consist of the value Vn divided by 2 power n or something like that. The last 3 bit DAC, I'll have V0 by 2 cube. Here I may have V0 by 2 power n. And Vn by 2 plus what else? Vn minus 1 by 2 square, something like that you're going to have. Okay. So you will have the values like this, and the rest of the values minus 2R by R and VR would remain as it is. So this can be the generalization for n bit DAC. This is the general equation for a 3 bit DAC. Do you have any doubts with this derivation? If you don't have any doubts, we can observe the same thing for a 4 bit DAC. So, example 2, consider a 4 bit R2R ladder DAC as shown below. You see, this is the circuit. This is same as the previous circuit what I had written. Only thing, we have considered a positive VREF. Plus VR has been considered, and that is taken as plus 5 volts. The R value is taken as 10K in the example, and 2R value will naturally be 20K. So you see, the last 2R resistor is grounded. The next 2R resistor here is connected to V0. The next 2R B1, B2, B3. It's a 4 bit ladder. And in between the 2Rs here, I have R, R, R. You can see this is how it is connected. But there is a slight change here. Actually, in the previous diagram, if you observe, we had 1R after this last 2R also. There are many versions of the DAC. Okay. So please understand, this is not the only version of the R2R ladder. We are using inverting R2R ladder. We can have non-inverting also, which you will do in the lab. You can do either inverting or non-inverting. The non-inverting version will use a slightly different condition. Okay. And even in inverting version, you see there is no R in this point. In this 4-bit R2R ladder version of the DAC, we haven't written an R here, whereas in the 3-bit ladder, there was one more R here. Okay. We had 3 R's and 4 2Rs there. Here we have 5 2Rs and only 3 R's. This RF will also be 2R as before. Okay. So even this version will work. Okay, so I can show you in this case also how we will get the output voltage corresponding to the input signals. Okay, so let us consider the case. What is the first case one, or the condition when B3, B2, B1, B0 are 1000. So at this point, I should get the output as almost half the reference voltage or half the full scale output voltage. Yes or no? So what should be the connections here? The connections here would be, as you can see, this figure. Here we have already made this connection. You see B0 is connected to ground. This is your ground. This lower line is the ground, the upper line corresponds to plus VR. Okay. I'm using a positive V reference and I'm not used this R. So even this circuit is fine. I told you there are many variants of the circuit. So we'll make this connection B0 to ground, B1 to ground, B2 to ground, whereas B3 should be connected to plus VR. You see B3 is connected to plus 5 volts. This is the initial connection which we are trying to make. Can you reduce this circuit for us now? What will the circuit, equivalent circuit, look like here? 2R, this last resistor. Then I have another 2R connected to ground, this resistor. Okay, this one. Then you have an R. Then you have 2R to ground. Then you have another R. Then you have 2R again grounded, this resistor. And then I have this R and a 2R here, which is connected to VR. This 2R is connected to VR, and this acts as the inverting input V2. The voltage at this point would be V2, which can be virtual ground from this. So if you see V1, which is non-inverting terminal, which is actually grounded, here you can see V2, which is the inverting terminal, would be the virtual ground. It will also be at zero potential because the differential input signal is very low that it can be considered as zero. Okay. So this is the equivalent circuit. Can you simplify? This in parallel with this 2R will result in R. R in series with R will be, so these two in series will then be 2R. Now from this point, if I take, this is point A, B, C, D. So from point B to ground, you have one 2R here and another 2R here. Again, 2R would be in parallel with 2R, which will reduce to R. That R in series with R will be 2R. Again, at point C, we'll analyze 2R and 2R in parallel, which would be R. Then R in series with this R is 2R. So in effect, you may see a resistance 2R connected from point D to the left to the ground, and another resistance of value 2R, which is connected to VR. So this is the circuit you may notice at the point D. Okay. You see, yeah, at point D, there is one 2R from the left. This is your point D to the left, 2R, and another point downwards, 2R, which is connected to plus 5 volts. So now how do I determine the effective voltage here? I will determine this in terms of currents. So the same analysis is clearly shown. Since the R value is 10K and this 2R is 20K, and inverting input is at virtual ground, whereas the non-inverting terminal actual ground. So what will be the current through the 2R resistor, which is connected to this one? What will happen to the current through the 2R resistor, which is connected to plus 5? See, this point is at ground, zero potential. V2 is virtual ground, this is actual ground. Since this end is at ground, what will be the value of current flowing through this? Current will flow in this direction because this point is connected to plus 5. V3 is connected to plus 5. So what would be the value of current here? The value of this current I is what? 5 minus 0 divided by 20K. The value of the resistance here is 20K. This will become 5 by 20K, which results in 0.25 milliamps. Now, this current I, which is coming in this point, can never go into the op-amp. No current can go into the op-amp because the op-amp has almost infinite or very large input resistance. So what happens to all the current coming here? This I will continue in this path. See, this analysis is very similar to the weighted resistor DAC analysis which we have done, right? So all the current I which is coming in this path will move through this RF. So what would be the value of output voltage here? The output voltage here will be or the voltage drop across RF, what would be the voltage drop across this? This end is at zero and this end is at V naught. So the voltage drop across this resistance VRF is 0 minus V naught, or it is minus V naught. And how will I find the value of this voltage? It can be found as the current I into RF, but with a negative sign. So V naught can be written as minus I into RF. What is the value of I? 0.25 milliamps. And what would be the value of V naught? I into RF with a negative sign, you will get around minus 5 volts. So the output voltage turns out to be around minus 5 volts in this case, which is almost same as the reference voltage which we connect. So for the condition when the MSB bit is 1, I am getting an output voltage which is almost equivalent or exactly equivalent to the VR. Okay. Likewise, for the next condition, your V2 will be connected to VREF. And one more thing, what you notice, you get a negative output value here. You are getting output as minus 5 because I have used positive V reference and I have connected all the signals to the inverting input of the op-amp. Whenever you connect the signals to the inverting input, you will always get a negative output, especially when you have connected a positive reference voltage. Is that clear? So the analysis here is slightly different. I have shown you two different ways of analyzing the same circuit and also two small different versions of the circuit. You can use either. Next, if B3 is 0 and B2 is 1, B1, B0 is 0, what would the equivalent circuit be? The equivalent circuit would be something like this. I would have 2R connected to ground, another 2R here. This corresponds to B0. B0 is grounded, as you can see. Then I have an R. Then I have another 2R. This corresponds to B1. B1 is also grounded. Then you have R. Then you have a 2R. This point is B2. What should B2 be? B2 should be logic 1. So this point should be connected to the plus 5 volts reference voltage VR. Then you have another R. Then you are going to have 2R. This is B3. B3 is also grounded here, MSB bit. And this would be your final input to the inverting terminal. From here you have RF, which is 2R again, RF, and you will get the output voltage here. So you can try to analyze in the same fashion like how we did before. Try to simplify this whole circuit to the left of this point and the circuit to the right of this point. Find the current here and find the current going. All the current which comes here will go through this resistor only. So you can find the expression for output voltage. So this is how it will reduce. So based, we'll not spend more time on this. We've already discussed one complete circuit. And even in the second circuit, we've discussed how the output voltage can be determined. So based on this, the output voltage will be somewhere like this. Say for decimal values of input ranging from 0 to 15, whenever you have a 4-bit binary number, I'll have the binary values ranging from all zeros to all ones. So the ones are shown as 5 volts here. This 5 volts corresponds to logic 1 and 0 corresponds to logic 0, the binary 0. So with these values, the decimal equivalent would be from 0 to 15, and you will observe the output has a step size of around 0.625 volts. You see, for the lowest input, what is the minimum input after 0? It is 0001. For this input, whatever the output voltage is, that will correspond to the step size or resolution. Okay. And you can see that If the step size is minus 0.625, the second step will be 2 times this value. So this into 2, I'll get the second value. This into 3, I'll get the third value, so on. It should follow in multiples of the basic step size. And since we are getting negative output, you will see the staircase moving downwards. There will be a 16-step staircase waveform, which can be easily generated using a mod 16 counter in the lab. If I connect a mod 16 counter 7493 to the output of the DAC, the R2R ladder you will design in the lab, and to the output resistors, wherever you have this R, like these points, wherever we have the two R's, I can connect these two R's to the output bits of a counter. You can have a counter, okay, and the outputs of the counter QD, QC, Q, you can connect this here, okay, QB and QA, and you can give an input clock of 1 hertz or 10 hertz or something like that. You will observe the output at this point. Wherever you observe, you will observe this kind of staircase waveform being generated. Anyway, you'll see the design of this completely in the lab. So this staircase can be easily generated. And you can observe the full scale output voltage is around minus 9.375 volts. One more thing which you should take care of: the full scale output voltage should always be less than plus VCC or minus VEE. What are these voltages? These are the bias voltage which you connect to the op amp. Remember, we give bias voltages at pin 7 and pin 4 for the op amp. The final output voltage which you get should be less than these values by at least 1 volt, because the op amp output will saturate at let's say 85 to 90% of this VCC. So I may get the maximum output. If I give 12 volts here, I may get maximum output of just 10.8 or 11 volts. Okay, so you should take care to see that your full scale output voltage should never reach the saturation limit. If it exceeds the saturation limit, you will not notice the change in the step size. You will notice a constant, the output will remain at a constant level. There won't be any change in the step size. Say minus VSAT it has reached, it will remain constant there. Okay, so the highest output voltage and other values should always be less than the saturation limit, which depends on the biasing power supplies of the op amp. Okay, so is this concept clear to you all? We'll discuss about this in our next class. Good morning. Let us consider the simulation of R2R ladder DAC, which we needed for the lab also. Actually, we'll be doing it using discrete circuits or discrete equipment, but because of this pandemic, I'll show you how to do it using multisim. So multisim software all of you should have had. Let me just show you. So once you install multisim and open, this is your drawing area. This is where you can construct the circuit. And here you have something called as place. Okay. So in this place, if you want a component, select component, there is a master database. And depending on which IC you want, whether you want TTL or whether you want analog IC, and in analog ICs, I want op amp 741. So I'll just choose. You see here component 741, say okay, automatically it comes. If you click once, left click, it will be placed there. It will again come to select a component. Here I want, once I have the op amp, I want basic components like resistors. So let me go to resistor here. And here, let me choose a resistor of 2.2K. Okay. I need 5 2.2K resistors. So let me just, each time I say, okay, a new component comes. You can also place one and copy and paste again. So I need 5 2.2K resistors. This is for 2R. Then for R, I'll use a 1K resistor. See, in under components, I type 1K. I say, okay. And I need 3Rs. Okay. Next, we'll move on to the sources, power sources. We need the ground. Okay. I'll take one or two grounds. Let it be there. DC power we need. Okay. One more DC power. One more. I'll tell you why we need the third one. So, these are the various things we need. Let me close this. Remember, this is the 741 op amp, and pin 7 should be connected to positive of the supply. So everything is here. I just have to select it and drag it to where it is needed. And if you want to flip it so that it will be easy to connect, do a control R. Yeah, now the positive edge has come here. Now, what should I do? I'll just keep my mouse cursor here and I'll click. Automatically the wiring starts and I'll just bring it to the point where I want to end it. You can see the one in red, a wire is connected. Now, the other end of this power supply should be grounded. So, carry this ground and place it here. And again, click here, bring the wire, connect it. It is done. Similarly, for pin 4, we need to connect this supply, but in the opposite direction. So I'll again say, I have used control R and I have connected this. The other end is grounded. So bring this ground here and connect this. Done. We are done with connecting plus 12 and minus 12 volts so that the op amp will be working. Now let's connect the all these resistors. All these resistors should be vertical. Okay. Remember, all the 2Rs are vertical and all these Rs are horizontal. Bring them here. Connect the first R to the non-inverting terminal of the op amp. Then bring one 2R resistor here. Connect this point. Connect another R here. You should always begin the connection from the unconnected component. I'll connect this to the other R. A third R is brought here. Now you connect it. So all you have to do is make the connections as you have in the circuit diagram. So I hope you understood how the connections are made. Just make all the connections. I should have one more 2R here. And this 2R should be grounded. Okay. And a 2R here. So all these 2R points are D3, D2, D1, D0, and this should be ground. So let me just copy this ground, Control C, Control V. You can see Yeah, you have the ground here. Connect it. And here I should give I should either connect them to VCC or to ground depending on the condition. So I have taken another DC source here. I'll bring that DC source and I'll connect one end of the DC source to ground. For logic 1, the value of this DC source should be 5 volts. So I'll double click on this and change it to 5 volts. Okay. And for logic 0, it should be grounded. So we can check the condition one by one. Say I want to make the least significant bit as logic high and all the others as logic 0. So you can just connect everything to ground here and you're connecting the least significant bit to logic high. And here op amp circuit we haven't completed. Remember, I can use something like a voltage follower here. So the inverting terminal is connected to the output. Done. We are done with the R2R ladder connection. So let us check the output of this R2R ladder, the same circuit I have here. To check the output, you see on the right hand side panel, I have a multimeter here, function generator and the multimeter. Can you see? This is multimeter. So I have connected a multimeter to the output and I have chosen different input combination here. Here I have chosen the input combination, remember, as 0100. As you can see here, it is 0010. So 2 for the binary input 2, what is the corresponding output? You run the simulation and you see this multimeter will be displaying the output value. You double click on the multimeter, you'll be able to see the output. So if you want to check the output for a different value, you can just stop the simulation. Okay. And you disconnect this. Let me remove this also. Let me connect D naught to logic high and all the remaining I'm going to connect to logic 0. Save it. So once you've connected, run the simulation again. Can you see the output of the multimeter changing to 340 millivolts or 0.3 volts? So for 0001, the output is 0.3 volts. That is the least step size of this R2R ladder DAC. And for 0010, that is for binary 2, the output was 2 times this. You got around 0.680 or something. And I can show it for another, say 0011, that is 3. So let me stop. Each time you have to stop the simulation, disconnect and see wherever I have to give logic 1, I should bring it to this 5 volt supply, whichever should be at binary 0, that should be connected to ground. As simple as that. So this is D3, D2 are grounded. D1, D0 are connected to plus 5, which means the value, binary input value is 0011. So let me run the simulation. Can you see the output is around 988.125? That is for decimal 3 value. The output is 3 times the minimum, that is 3 times 0.3 volts, which will be around 0.9 volts. So likewise, you can go on trying. Let me show once for all high, what would be the output you're going to see when everything is connected to logic 1. So I'll just connect this also to high and this also to high. So all the 4 inputs are connected to logic 1. Run the simulation. This is the full scale output voltage, what you're going to observe. So in this R2R ladder DAC, you are able to observe the full scale analog output voltage of 4.661 volts for a digital input, which is a 4-bit digital input, which is all ones. Okay. So now with the same thing, I have just modified the circuit by including a counter. Let me stop this simulation. Let me go to the circuit with the counter. I have included 7493, which is what? Mod 16 counter. 7493 is connected as a, it's a binary ripple counter. I have connected it as a mod 16 counter, which means I have to short this clock B to QA. Remember, internally there will be divide by 2 and divide by 8. So for the divide by 8 counter, the clock is clock B. So you are going to connect, this clock B to the output of divide by 2 counter, that is QA. You see here pin 1 is connected to pin 12. Pin 12 is QA. And we give the actual clock signal generator to a function generator. I'm going to use a square wave or a pulse. Okay. So the actual clock is given here to pin 14, which is the clock input of the divide by 2 counter. The clock input of divide by 8 counter is connected to the output bit of divide by 2 counter, that is QA. Pin 12 and pin 1 are shorted. And you see D0 bit is connected to QA, D1 is connected to QB, D2 connected to QC, and D3 is connected to QD. Okay. So these are the various connections. And you also can observe that I'm going to use an oscilloscope to observe the output rather than multimeter here, because I want to see a staircase being generated as I'm going to generate the input signal. So let me just show you how that staircase is generated. I'll just simulate this. I'll double click on the oscilloscope. Can you see this waveform being generated and the staircase being generated? So this staircase will have 16 steps if you count, as for every clock pulse, input clock pulse, the output increases by one step because we are feeding it to the modulo 16 counter. Because I'm connecting this clock to the mod 16 counter, you're able to observe the increase in the step, and totally there would be 16 steps generated, as you can observe. And in order to generate this, what is the, I'm setting in, I'm choosing a square wave. I'm setting the frequency as 1 kilohertz, 50% duty cycle. And I'm using the amplitude of the square wave to be 2.5 volts peak. So totally it will be 5 volts peak to peak, nothing else. So with this and with the oscilloscope connected, you can clearly observe a beautiful staircase being generated. Okay. I have adjusted this time per division knob. If you want to see the rising slowly and count, you change this time per division knob, you will be able to count 16 steps happening. Okay. So this is R2R ladder DAC with counter. So hope you understood both these. You observe, and if you have any doubts, you can get back to me. Thank you.